Oh, there we are. Good morning. This is VK3 Echo Kilo Hotel, VK3 EKH, coming to the official station of the Astronomical Society of Victoria, coming to you from the studios of VK3 CSJ in Narre Warren South. This is VK3 Echo Kilo Hotel, broadcasting on prime frequency of 3541 kHz in the 80 metre amateur radio band, and simulcasting on 160 metres on 1865 amplitude modulation. Good old AM. We're also broadcasting via the Melbourne television repeater, VK3RTV, digital channel 1, which is streaming to the BATC website, the British Amateur Television Club video stream. So you can see the BATC stream there. I can see that it's happening. There it is. And also you can find the video stream on YouTube. You can just go to the Google search engine and look for VK3CSJ and find the live tab, and just click on the live tab and you'll see the live stream in full HD if you can't receive RTV. We also have an email address, which I am now going to go to the inbox as I speak. So if anybody wishes to send signal reports, the email is vk3ekh@gmail.com, vk3ekh@gmail.com, and I'm looking at the inbox as I speak. We also have a Discord chat window operational with a stream, I believe, that's running, a video stream as well, which can be found from the ASV website under the Radio Astronomy tab, www.asv.org.au. Go across to where you see Radio Astronomy and click on that, and that'll drop a box down to the ASV broadcast, ASV radio broadcast, and click on that and then you'll see the various streams. The YouTube stream will be there, as well as the little Discord icon. It's a radio telescope icon, and click on that and you'll get into the Discord chat window. And as I speak, there's already three folks that are up on the chat window. G'day Martin, VK7JAH, down there in Launceston, and Richard, VK3VRS. All right, we're back on deck, ladies and gentlemen, after 2 or 3 weeks, I've lost count, to be honest. The whole month of August has been a bit of a blur, and we're back here for the 2nd of September, new month, and let's hope we can continue on now for the rest of the year without too many issues. So you're tuned to ASV Radio, VK3 Echo Kilo Hotel, the official station of the Astronomical Society of Victoria, with the regular Friday night broadcast as it is. Okay, so we've got a few things tonight, but I'll just go through the usual introduction to the ASV. The Astronomical Society of Victoria, founded in 1922, comprises over 1,600 members throughout Victoria and Australia. Membership of the Society is open to all persons with an interest in astronomy. The Society's objectives are to encourage the study and practice of astronomy, to disseminate the knowledge of the science, and to provide greater facilities for the study among its members. Monthly meetings are usually held on the second Wednesday of each month, except in January, with the latter being held on a Saturday night. Meetings start at 8 p.m. in the Mullier Hall, National Herbarium, in Burwood Avenue, Melbourne, near the Melbourne Observatory, which is located adjacent to the Shrine of Remembrance. Parking is available in Burwood Avenue, Dulles Brooks Drive, and within the surrounding streets. Admission is free and visitors are most welcome. Privileges of membership include the right to borrow books, periodicals, and other publications from the Society's extensive library located at Melbourne Observatory, receipt of the ASV magazine Crux containing articles, news, observing notes, and the like, and the free provision of the Astronomical Yearbook. Access is available to telescopes on members' nights held regularly at the Melbourne Observatory and after monthly meetings, weather permitting. These instruments include this, the Society's 300mm equatorial reflector and a 300mm portable reflector. There's also a 200mm refractor managed by the Royal Botanic Gardens, and a photoheliograph are also housed at the observatory and are accessible to members as well. The Society is also has a number of 200mm reflectors available for short period loan, so members can try before they buy. Members are also encouraged to make use of the Society's country property located near Heathcote, some 90-minute drive north of Melbourne. There are a range of instruments available for members to use, the larger two only with appropriate training, and they range from 300mm to 1000mm aperture. Also located on the site is a 8.5 fully steerable radio telescope, which members can access with involvement in the radio astronomy section. Members are encouraged to make and use telescopes. Advice and help on both matters are provided willingly to newcomers desiring to do the same. Instrument making is only one of the number of common interest activities catered for within the Society. There are, in fact, 20 sections that make up the bulk activity groups. They are astro in alphabetical order, astrophotography, Bendigo section, the club section, comet section, computing section, cosmology and astrophysics, deep sky, demonstrators section, diurnals, Great Melbourne Telescope section, historical section, instrument making, juniors, lunar and planetary, meteor section, new astronomers group, outdoor lightning improvement group, radio astronomy, solar and space exploration. All those groups there always gather a number of people that all share a common interest to find out what's the latest, contribute ideas, and if any of those sections sound of some value to you, you're more than welcome to get in contact with the section director of those groups or sections and ask if you'd like to step in on a Zoom meeting or a Yahoo meeting. I think there's one there that might still have a Yahoo group that's running. But I think Zoom meetings are still quite on the go. And very soon there'll be a new club room that members will be able to attend for a more personal get-together, which we've all missed very much. So, apart from all that, further information, of course, can be gleaned from the website at www.asv.org.au. That's www.asv.org.au. And more information about the Society is available at that website. So there's a few things coming up, in fact, in the next couple of months leading up to the Melbourne Cup weekend particularly. Over that Melbourne Cup weekend, we've got the ASV have got something called the Sea Lake Astro Fest. Now, from what I gather, all tickets have been booked, so the Sea Lake Astro Fest is booked out. So I wish everybody who's attending the Sea Lake Astro Fest up there at northwestern Victoria a great weekend. I hope the weather plays nice, but it should be quite a fun weekend for all that's involved with that. That's just one of the many things that ASV get up to. In fact, probably what's coming up even sooner, this month, is the Galactic Star Party. And that's, I can't see it on the homepage here for some reason. Just going to quickly go down the calendar. I can't see it in that immediate calendar there, but I know that we have there's usually three big astronomical events that occur throughout the year, and the one is the Messier Star Party early in the year, Galactic Star Party at this time of the year, and of course the big do, the Christmas star party. And usually the star parties that are open to public at that time. So yes, there we are. So the Galactic Star Party is slated for the 24th of September from 3 p.m. to Sunday. And although it does say here members only, okay. All right, for some reason I thought the Galactic Star Party also had a public open to public thing, but I'm just noticing here it says members only. So you have to become a member. Anyway, and that's easy to do. If you want to become a member of ASV, again, it's all from the homepage. Where just under where it says Welcome to the Astronomical Society, there's a little membership icon highlighted, and click on that, and it's easy peasy, Japanese-y, all via PayPal, and fairly easy to do. Alrighty then, so that's enough of that. Being the beginning of the month, we can now talk about some sky notes from the Melbourne Planetarium, courtesy, I think, of Tanya Hill. I still haven't found that out whether Tanya Hill is comprising these sky notes. She used to, but I don't know whether she's doing that now. Anyway, this is the sky notes for September 2022. And of course, it's the spring equinox this month. Here in the Southern Hemisphere, we are inexorably moving towards spring equinox, or sometimes called the vernal equinox, from the Latin ver for springtime, a period of new growth. How appropriate. From ancient Latin for equal night, this is when day and night are effectively the same length. Globally, the equinox will be on Friday the 23rd and marks the mid-year change of seasons, end of winter and the beginning of spring in the Southern Hemisphere, and end of summer and start of autumn in the Northern Hemisphere. At equinoxes, the sun shines directly on the equator and both hemispheres receive equal amounts of daylight. The explanation for equinoxes and the main reason for the seasons lies in our planet's tilted axis of rotation, which is effectively fixed at 23.5 degrees with respect to its orbit around the sun. This means that in spring and autumn, neither hemisphere leans towards the sun. During spring or autumn in mid-latitudes, the sun's rays strike the ground obliquely. This is very different to summer, when the steep angle of rays gives greater energy per square meter, and the shallow one of winter, which gives less energy. At these times, the sun's path in the sky is midway between summer, when it is high and long with more hours of daylight, and winter, when the path is low and short with fewer daylight hours. However, the actual date of equal day and night for any given location is dependent on its latitude. For Melbourne, the latitude of 37.8 degrees south, it will be September 20, a couple of days earlier, with sunrise at 6:13 a.m. and sunset at 6:14 p.m. It is often said that day and night are equal at the equinox, but this is not quite so. The astronomical timings are based on exactly when and for how long the center point of the sun's disk is above the horizon. But the local day effectively starts when the leading edge or limb of the sun broaches the eastern horizon, and ends when its trailing edge or limb drops below the western horizon. There is a counterintuitive terrestrial effect as well. The atmosphere refracts or bends light from the sun, so that sunrise we get the first glimpse of the sun before it physically crosses the horizon. The reverse occurs at sunset, when we see the sun for a few minutes after it has already sunk below the western horizon. So, sunrise and sunset times for September. On Thursday, the 1st of September, sunrise was at 6:42, setting at 5:58, with a day length of 11 hours and 16 minutes. On Sunday, the 11th of September, sunrise will be at 6:27, setting at 6:07. Wednesday, the 21st of September, it will rise at 6:11, setting at 6:15. And on Friday, the 30th, it'll rise at 5:57, setting at 6:23, with the day length being 12 hours and 25 minutes, getting longer. Moon phases. On the 4th of September, Sunday, we see a first quarter. On the 10th, Saturday, a full moon. On the 18th, Sunday, will be a third quarter phase. And on the 26th of Monday, 26th, it'll be a new moon. And if you're interested to know how far away moon will be, on Thursday, the 8th of September, it is lunar perigee, nearest to the Earth, at 364,492 kilometres. And then on Tuesday, the 20th of September, is lunar apogee, furthest from the Earth, at 404,556 kilometres. Okay, now there's a little bit of a write-up here on Voyager. And there's actually an image here I can bring up. So if anybody is watching the TV and or YouTube, there is a of an image I'm about to bring up, if I can just find it. Okay. Oh, well, that's interesting. I didn't save it. I thought I did. Well, wouldn't that bother you? I thought to do it. I thought I did do it. In fact, probably did, but I just haven't brought it into vMix. So let me just see if I can locate this image of Voyager here. That shan't take too long. There it is. Okay. Yep, I just didn't bring it into vMix for some reason. It's always something, isn't it? Let me just bring the other image in. There's two of them about Voyager. And no, go back. Just bear with me for a second, ladies and gentlemen, while we just get the image here sorted out. There's the other one. Open, okay, and it is now in vMix. vMix is my key digital video mixer, HD. All right, I'll bring up this image. There it is. Okay, for those watching VK3RTV and the YouTube stream and the BATC stream can see this. all right, what have we got here? Anyway, okay, so what you're seeing there is the image, the first single frame image of the Earth and Moon taken by Voyager 1 on the 18th of September 1977. From a distance of 11.6 million kilometres on its way to Jupiter. So it's a rare photograph. We don't often get images of the Earth-Moon system, but from a distance of 11.6 million kilometres, there it is, Earth and Moon, taken on the 18th of September. So pretty good, I reckon, that is. All right, now there's just one more image here. Of course, this is just a an illustration of the Voyager probe. There it is. And what they say here is that Voyager's high-gain antenna, seen at the center of this illustration of NASA's spacecraft, is one component controlled by the Attitude Articulation and Control System, AACS. On the short boom to the left is the radiothermal power unit. The long boom, extending to the upper left, has a sensitive magnetometer. On the right is an instrument and camera boom, and at center on the spacecraft's main body is the famous golden record that Carl Sagan had a lot to do with. to commemorate Voyager 1's launch in September 1977 and that of its twin co-explorer Voyager 2 that launched 16 days earlier, and the amazing ongoing mission that continues after 45 years. There's seven links they provide here on SkyNotes. So if you just type in your favorite search engine SkyNotes, the Planetarium, Melbourne Planetarium, you can see this September SkyNotes, and there's got various links here about Voyager 2, the mission, the spacecraft, worlds, the golden record, videos, Carl Sagan's pale blue dot, solar system, family portrait. So all those are very, very interesting links. Okay. All right, continuing on with SkyNotes. Planets. Mercury is too close to the Sun this month as it approaches inferior solar conjunction, when it will be directly in front of the Sun from our vantage point on Earth. See conjunctions, oppositions, and many other topics on Swinburne Astronomy Online Encyclopedia called Cosmos. Venus is now lost in morning light and is about to pass behind the Sun. Once its passage behind the Sun has ended, Venus will reappear in January in the west as the evening star. Mars is going to be very easy to spot this month, breaching the horizon at 1 a.m. in the morning and getting high enough to be seen at around 2 a.m. It will be quite bright and easily spotted until it progressively fades with the dawn light. The red planet is a beautiful sight, and especially its polar ice caps, which may be revealed with a large telescope. Jupiter. Jupiter is going to be in opposition towards the end of the month and will be easily spotted in the suburban sky from just before 9 p.m. to around 6 a.m. when the light of the morning slowly extinguishes its light, taking slightly longer to do so than Mars, as it is the brightest object in the entire night sky. If you are viewing it through a telescope, you'll be more than likely to see one or two of the four Galilean moons, named after the famous astronomer Galileo Galilei, the moon's discoverer. Saturn will be approaching opposition early this month, about 2 weeks before Jupiter, and will be at its brightest during this time. It is already above the horizon by late afternoon, but only becomes visible as dusk sets in and the sky darkens, revealing the most beautiful planet of our solar system. Those rings will set your eyes alight, should you get a chance to view it through a telescope. It will set in the sky around 5 a.m., just before dawn would cause it to be lost in the day. Uranus is a bit harder to spot than the three aforementioned planets, being quite a lot duller than them all. It rises around 2 a.m., but it is quite low in the sky all night and as such might be hard to spot, even in a large and open parkland. It is lost quite early to the morning light, just after 5 a.m., but would be too low in most cases to be seen at any time anyway. Under dark skies and with binoculars or a modest telescope, it is an excellent challenge for a nighttime stargazers. Neptune. Neptune, the beautiful deep blue planet, will rise from about 9 p.m., reaching its highest point in the sky for the night at a quarter past one in the morning. Its deep blue colours will not be visible to the naked eye, or most telescopes even, but it is still a fascinating planet and well worth to look if you can. It is also lost to the early twilight, much the same as Uranus. Meteors. While not a good time for meteors this month, the southern Pisces will peak from the 11th to the 20th. They usually number only a few per hour and appear in the constellation Pisces the Fish, which rises in the northwest from midnight. For more information about NASA asteroids and comets and meteors, Actually, there's a link they provide there. Find out more about these space visitors at NASA's Asteroids, Comets, and Meteors. It's a link. But having said that, Heavens Above is another good site to go to for information on that. Stars and constellations in the north, looking towards the north, high in the north are Sagittarius, the Archer, Centaur. Its bow and arrow forms the famous asterism, the teapot, the spout of which leads across the zenith to the curving tail of nearby Scorpius. Lower in the north sits Aquila, the eagle, with Alta or the Alpha Aquilae, the 12th brightest star at night, and quite low in the north is Lyra, and its principal star Vega, or Alpha Lyrae, which is the 5th brightest star at night. In the east, directly east this month, is a trio of adjacent constellations. In the center is Aquarius, the water bearer, while above is Capricornus, the goat, and to its left sits Pisces, containing its main star and the 18th brightest star at night, Formal Hut, in Alpha Pisces Austrinus. You have to learn how to speak Latin in some cases. In the south, looking towards the south, low in the southwest can easily be seen two of the brightest stars in the night sky, Alpha and Beta Centauri. These are two brightest stars in the constellation of Centaurus the Centaur, with Alpha Centauri also known as Regal Centaurus, with a K, which is the foot of the centaur. Together, these two stars are referred to as the pointers, as they lead directly to the unmistakable diamond shape of the Crux, or Southern Cross. Crux is the smallest of the traditional 88 constellations astronomers use and is an easy feature of the night sky to observe, even in city surroundings. In the southeast is the 10th brightest star, Achernar, in the long constellation of Arindus, the river, Arindinus, that winds its way down to the horizon. In the west, high in the west sits the curving tail, body and pinnacles of the scorpion, pinches, maybe that is what that word is, of the scorpion, Scorpius. Within its body, you should see red giant star Antares, which will appear more orange than red in light polluted skies. In the front of the scorpion's wide head and closer to the horizon sits Libra, the scales. All right, the International Space Station. At a distance of about 400 kilometers, the ISS completes an orbit every 90 minutes and appears as a bright point slowly moving across the night sky. Here are some of the brightest passes expected this month over Melbourne. On the morning of Thursday the 22nd, there's a passing at 5:04 a.m. to 5:09, coming in from the northwest to the southeast. Then on the morning of Sunday the 25th, there's a passing at again at 5:04 a.m. to 5:09 a.m. northwest to southeast. In the evening, on Monday the 5th, this coming Monday, there's a passing at 6:57 p.m. to 7:03 p.m. coming in from the southwest to the northeast. Having said that, if you go to the Heavens Above website, Heavens Above gives predictions for visible passes of space stations and major satellites, live sky views and 3D visualizations. Be sure to first enter your location under the configuration so you can get exact times when these passes occur. But again, Heavens Above is a great online resource for what is in the skies above our head. All right, now there's a few dates here. I'll just quickly go through some of the dates. On this day, on the 1st of September 1939, Americans J. Robert Oppenheimer and Hartland Snyder publish the first paper that describes the gravitational contraction of a star, which later led to the modern concept of black holes. Also on the 1st of September 1859 is the well-known Carrington event, most powerful geomagnetic storm ever recorded, now understood as a coronal mass ejection, CME, from the Sun that hit the Earth's magnetosphere, inducing strong northern auroras almost to the equator and telegraph interference in Europe, North America, with operators receiving electrical shocks, poles that sparked, and signals sent despite power being cut off. We need another one of those. Also on the 1st of September 1979, Pioneer 11 made the first flyby of Saturn, returning the first close-up images of the planet. It was the second probe to pass the asteroid belt and Jupiter and to reach solar escape velocity. Last routine contact was on 30th September 1995. And final data received was on November 1995. On the 5th of September 1977, Voyager 1 is launched to explore the outer solar system. After 42 years, it continues sending data and is the most distant probe at 21.8 billion kilometres, or 146 AU. It entered interstellar space in 2012, and its power supply may last until 2025. On the 8th of September 2004, Genesis probe crashes in Utah while returning samples of the solar wind particles. Some collecting panels survived impact and were recovered, giving successful scientific results. On the 11th of September 1985, the International Cometary Explorer, or ICE, ICE, became the first spacecraft to encounter a comet by flying through the dust tail of the comet Giacobini-Zinna. Also on the 14th of September 1959, Luna 2 USSR was the first craft to fly to and impact another body, in this case the moon. It crashed, in other words. It released sodium gas to allow visible tracking, used radio for telemetry transmissions, and crashed into Mare Imbrium, the Sea of Rains. And I'll just give two more dates. The 17th of September 1976, NASA unveils its concept for a space transportation system, a rocket launched and a glider return orbiter known as the Space Shuttle. That was 1976. Also on the 17th of September 1857 is the birth of Konstantin Ur. It's a Russian name, I think. Yeah, it is. Konstantin Tsiolkovsky. There we are, that'll do. Who was a pioneering Russian, then Soviet teacher, whose theoretical work on aerodynamics and rocketry influenced all who followed. He advocated spaceflight and believed humans would colonize the galaxy. What a dream. That was 1857. Konstantin. I won't bother. But anyway, there it is. All right, there's a bunch of others. Not many other dates, actually. It's only about four other interesting dates. I'll leave that till next week. You're tuned to ASV Radio, VK3EKH, coming to you from the studios of Narre Warren South. All right, next we have on the list is, I just have a quick look at my emails. We have an email from Don, VK3HDX, and we also have an email from Mr. Lewis, VK3GL, and both say, glad you're back tonight. 80 metres is 5 and 9, 40 and 160 is 5 and 9, 30. YouTube and RTV looks good, so everything's cool in that area. Graham says that he is saying, welcome back, listening tonight while working this evening, and should be able to check in at the on the callback. So thank you, Graham, and thank you, Don. Anybody else wishing to send signal reports and such things can email me at vk3ekh@gmail.com, vk3ekh@gmail.com. Looking at the chat window, we have a few others that have come into the group. We've got Andrew, VK3 Bravo Quebec. G'day, Andrew. We have Kim, VK5 FUSE there. We also have, and that's it for the time being. So thank you guys, chatting away to yourselves up there, not listening to me at all. That's fine by me. All right. So having said all that, this is VK3 Echo Kilo Hotel. Where's my page? Sky Notes. No, I've done that. All right. Oh, yeah. Okay. Now, this is an article I've left over for a couple of weeks, but I'll do it because I think it's interesting. Astronomers find glowing gas around a baby planet. The ELMA radio telescope may have spotted the third known circumplanetary disk known at this point in time. There is an image, and I shall bring that up on the screen. Okay, there she blows. And what do we have here? Okay, so there's one other image I had. Oh, it doesn't matter. Observing planets in the process of being born is a challenging task, but in recent years, radio telescopes like the Akakama Large Millimeter Submillimeter Array, ELMA, have captured images of glowing disks of material around young stars. The image above, shown here on the TV screen, YouTube, wherever, the image shows one such circumstellar disk around the star AS209. It's roughly 395 light years away in the constellation Orpheus. The gaps in the disk are where present nascent planets are being born. Nascent, N-A-S-C-E-N-T, nascent planets are being born, sweeping up gas and dust into their surface as they orbit. So that's the reason for the gaps. So planets are being born, created, and this is the early beginnings of such a thing. That's how our own solar system would have started many years ago. Billions, in fact. Even rarer is to observe the much smaller and fainter glowing disk of material swirling around a forming planet itself, from which moons might begin to accrete. Until recently, only two such circumplanetary disks had ever been spotted and confirmed. Those studies observed the hot gases in CPDs. Now, astronomers have found what may be the third CPD, circumplanetary disk, and for the first time, they think they have detected not its dust, but the fainter, much fainter emission from gas in the disk itself. While dust glows like a light bulb across the spectrum of wavelengths, the radiation emitted by gas emits only at specific wavelengths. But by using ELMA, the team were able to identify light emitted by carbon monoxide gas coming from the otherwise empty gap in the disk of AS209. The work was published July 27 in the Astrophysical Journal Letters. What made the gas around the nascent planet visible is the sheer size of the forming planet and its distance from its host star. Previous CPDs were only about one astronomical unit in diameter, or the average Earth-Sun distance. The CPD in AS209 is much larger, perhaps as large as 14 AU across, and orbits 200 AU from its host star, over five times the average distance of Pluto from our Sun, that distance. Being able to survey gas is an important milestone because gas marks up the vast majority, or makes up the vast majority, of the material that forms stars and planets. The relative ratio of gas to dust is on the order of 100 to 1. This means that the overall dynamics of CPDs must be determined by the gas, not dust. The astronomers say that we need to study the gas to fully understand CPDs and their capability of forming the moons. So it is really exciting that we directly detect the gas emission. Yes, that's what I thought. Okay, you're tuned to ASV Radio, VK3EKH. Now, here's a little bit of an update on Artemis, which was meant to launch last week. As we all know, I think it was Monday evening, we were all hanging out to see the huge rocket, which I believe is bigger than the Saturn V rocket, went to the moon. But anyway, they had to close that down, the launch, shut it down until they just got it sorted out. Well, anyway, let's just quickly go through this latest on the Artemis. We've got a picture here I can bring up, of course. Just bring that up on the TV. There it is, good old Artemis. Okay, this uncrewed mission. Just get a glass of water. This uncrewed mission will test critical technology for the first human expeditions to the moon in five decades, September 1, 2022. In this picture, you see NASA's Space Launch System sit on Launch Pad 39B at August 30 at the Kennedy Space Center, ready to launch the Orion capsule on Artemis 1 mission. So, we're going back to the moon, question mark. We are, and if NASA hopes and plans are met, not just back, but this time to stay. So, what is Artemis 1, you might ask? The uncrewed Artemis 1 mission, delayed multiple times but set to launch as soon as Saturday, tomorrow, is the first in a series of planned missions that mark NASA's return to the moon. As soon as 2 years from now, Artemis 2 will take a crew to lunar orbit. Artemis 3 is planned mission that will return humans to the lunar surface, landing the first woman and the first person of color on the moon. That mission is scheduled for 2025, though many observers wonder if such an ambitious schedule can be met. Dates and plans are likely subject to change, but Artemis program, named for Apollo's twin sister, is moving forward. It is the first effort to send humans to deep space since the end of Apollo in 1972, 50 years ago. So, what rocket is Artemis 1 using, you might ask? The Artemis 1's mission will be the first launch of NASA's Mega Moon rocket. The Space Launch System, Space Launch System, which, if successful, would be the most powerful rocket ever, based on a mix of new technology and heritage propulsion systems from the space shuttle era. The SLS is years behind schedule and over budget, but it has its proponents in Congress, and at some point out, like space policy expert Casey Deer of the Planetary Society, the SLS was never meant to compete with recent rise of reusable spacecrafts. That said, some think the SLS won't outlive these newer vehicles. For now, though, it is our moon ride. Each Artemis mission, at least early on, will cost about $4 billion. Critics point to the cost and delays, Advocates point to the exciting new science, the possibility that humans can live on another world long-term and do so sustainably, as well as likely inspiration that such a program provides humanity and industry. Off-sited, the Apollo guidance computer was the first major miniaturization of computers, and all you have to do is pull out your smartphone to see where that led. There's just another image here I shall bring up. That image on the screen right now is a kind of a bit of a breakdown of the launch space launch system. What you're seeing is the engines used in the core stage of the space launch system are repurposed main engines from the space shuttle. Struth. When's the launch, you might ask? Well, NASA is targeting a launch on Saturday, September 3, between 2:17 p.m. and 4:17 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time in America, of course. The first launch window opened for 2 hours on Monday, August 29. Launch windows are set because flight controllers must account for the motion of the Earth and the Moon and the rocket itself. But the rocket didn't launch. NASA managers briefed the press after the exhausting several hours, pointing to several glitches, including a lightning delay that set back fuel loading. The a Tichy hydrogen leak, they call it. Tichy hydrogen leak and a valve problem. The main showstopper was one of the core stage's main engines not cooling to the temperature needed for the launch. Still, even if it had been resolved, there were weather complications during the launch window that would have stalled the attempt anyway. If the SLS doesn't launch on Saturday, another window occurs on Monday, the 5th of September, at around 5 p.m. After that, more windows open later this month. So, what's the mission? And there's another image here I can bring up. So let's just do that quickly. It's more of an artist's impression, I guess. After liftoff, the Orion capsule and its service module, built by the European Space Agency, will go into Earth orbit and the solar panels will deploy. Then, about 90 minutes into the mission, the interim cryogenic propulsion stage, ICPS, will light up for about 20 minutes. That's translunar injection, TLI, the rocket burn that will propel Orion out of Earth's orbit and on its way to the Moon. After TLI, the ICPS will be jettisoned and Artemis 1 will be on its way for a full 4-day journey to the Moon. Along the way, it will launch 10 CubeSats, small inexpensive satellites, which research targets ranging from studying lunar water ice to measuring deep space radiation. In the picture on the screen right now, this is for Artemis 1's crew. NASA has supplied one male mannequin, while ESA has contributed two partial female mannequins. ESA's mannequins are designed to study the impacts of radiation, and breast cancer and ovarian cancer have a great chance of developing due to radiation exposure. How in the hell? NASA is stressing the craft beyond normal parameters on this first test flight. But don't worry, no one is aboard except a set of full and partial mannequins equipped with sensors to monitor the impact of radiation on future human astronauts. The mannequins are named Commander Moonclin Campos, Helga, and Zoa. The commander's last name is a gesture to honor engineer Arturo Campos, who played a pivotal role in getting Apollo 13 home from its nearly fatal lunar mission. As Orion approaches the Moon on its sixth day in space, it will make a flyby of the Moon, swooping to within 60 miles, 100 kilometers, of the lunar surface. As it does so, it will fire its rockets, but not to slow down. Instead, it will boost its momentum to carry it further from the Moon toward its eventual lunar orbit. That's because, unlike Apollo missions, which kept to a tight near circular orbit around the Moon, Artemis 1 will use a much wider orbit called a distant retrograde orbit, or a DRO. Retrograde means the craft will be orbiting in the opposite direction that the Moon orbits to the Earth. On the mission's 10th day, Artemis will fire its engines again, this time to slow down and finally enter DRO, distant retrograde orbit, where it will stay for 16 days. While in this orbit, Orion will venture farther into space than any human-rated craft in history. The most distant point of its orbit will be 40,000 miles or 64,000 kilometers beyond the Moon's far side, breaking the record held by Apollo 13. Eventually, NASA and its international partners will position a small spacecraft called the Gateway in a looping orbit called a near rectilinear halo orbit. That station will serve as an outpost when Artemis crews will transfer from the Orion capsule to the landing craft, a modified SpaceX Starship. For Artemis 3, however, Orion will meet up in lunar orbit directly with a lander. After Artemis 1 completes 1.5 orbits in DRO, it's back to Earth for an early October splashdown in the Pacific. That's a critical part of the mission to test the heat shield before humans fly on Artemis 2. Orion will come in faster than any crewed spacecraft before at 40,000 kilometers an hour and some 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit or 2,800 degrees Celsius. The heat shield has to work. And there's just one other image here which kind of shows the overall flight pattern that's going to happen. So they say here that oh dear. So what you're seeing on the screen there, Artemis 1 will use the Moon's gravity to slingshot it into distant retrograde orbit, DRO, a highly stable orbit. NASA's originally studied DRO for the asteroid redirect mission, a proposed mission that would capture an asteroid and place it into a DRO for easy access to study. How about that? So they're saying here, but why are we going back to the Moon anyway? We've been there already, right? That's a question. So they say, our understanding of the Moon today is vastly different from that during the age of the Apollo. Once thought to be a bone dry, scientists have found that the Moon has vast deposits of water ice, especially in the South Pole, near which Artemis 3 is set to land. There, water ice has accumulated for billions of years from a variety of sources, kept stable in permanently shadowed regions. Yet on the rim of some of the craters in the polar region, the sun shines nearly constantly. It's the perfect combination of power for solar panels and water for drinking, making oxygen and making rocket fuel. In 2024, NASA will send a rover called Viper, which is Volatiles Investigating Polar Exploration Rover. They love their acronyms. To that region to scout out what will surely be a dramatic landscape. Finding water on the Moon has the potential to be a game changer. NASA's current mantra for crewed mission exploration is Moon to Mars. By utilizing water ice on the Moon, NASA hopes to learn how to live off the land in an environment with a lot of radiation, vast differences in temperature, nasty dust, and more, training around for living on Mars. Some are advocating astronauts settle down in lunar lava pits, shielded from many of those hazards. It would be high-tech return to our species' cave-dwelling roots as we plan forays to the red planet, perhaps fueled by lunar ice turned into rocket fuel. But NASA's goals aren't just settlement. They're also, of course, scientific. The moon's water harbours clues to the ancient past of our solar system, and the surface offers places for special kinds of work. The far side is a perfect for radio astronomy, for example, shielding from the Earth, and it's very, very quiet there. NASA is not alone in this moon rush. Private companies are sending robotic missions, and Russia and China are collaborating on plans for a moon base and space station. China is pushing ahead, having demonstrated real chops at developing a serious program for space exploration. It's not quite the Cold War, but it's gotten Washington's attention, of course. Finally, how are we doing this, you might ask? There's no more images, so I'll just go back to the camera. So how are we doing this, they say? Well, of course, with rockets. But seriously, NASA is partnering with other countries and agencies, most notably ESA, whose service module for Orion serves as the spacecraft's power and support vehicle. NASA is touting its global partnerships, and multiple countries have signed the Artemis Accords, pledging cooperation and careful stewardship of the moon and space environment. Not everyone thinks it's enough to prevent over-exploitation, unnecessary scarring of an ancient world, or even conflict and hostilities with other players. A lot of policy and legal reflection is underway. Advocates believe Artemis can be our first baby steps, if not giant step leaps, in becoming a multi-planetary species while also benefiting our home world through innovation and perhaps even showing us more cooperative ways of living together. And of course, the last thing is, how can I follow the mission if you're interested in following it? That's the easy question of all. Your best bet is NASA TV, which will begin coverage of a couple of hours ahead of the first launch window. You can find it on NASA's website and on YouTube. NASA will also cover Orion's first outbound trajectory burn later that night. A full schedule of the planned programming is on the NASA's website. All right, so that's it. You're tuned to ASV Radio, VK3EKH, the official station of the Astro Society, that one. The Astronomical Society of Victoria. All right, I can see that we're coming up to the hour. I did have the Space Weather Woman as well, but I won't worry about that. It goes for 13 minutes. I might play it in full after I finish the cast on RTV. But it's old news. It's all last week, so there's nothing particularly new in Tamitha's report. So it doesn't matter. Okay. Oh, yeah. All right, just before I do space weather, there's one other little article here, and I'll bring up the picture I've got for that. I'll be paraphrasing this one. The James Webb Space Telescope detects carbon dioxide in the atmosphere of an exoplanet for the first time. The detection marks a new level of detail previously unmatched by other observatories. The James Webb Space Telescope wowed the world with its first science images released on July 12, which included data on chemical composition of exoplanet's atmosphere, but that was just a glimpse of what JWST has to offer. Now, JWST has taken its first peer-reviewed spectrum of an extrasolar planet's atmosphere. This time, scientists looked at WASP-39b, a Saturn-like world orbiting extremely close to its parent star, with each orbit by only taking about 4.1 days. The data, which has been accepted for publication in Nature, revealed the clearest evidence ever collected for carbon dioxide, CO2, in an exoplanet's atmosphere. So in the chart that you're seeing on the screen right now, this is the bump, the CO2 bump. And of course, it was not surprising, but it was still an exciting confirmation of older, less detailed data taken by WASP-39b. So due to its prevalence in our own solar system, CO2 may not be the first groundbreaking of molecules to find, but it does have important implications for planetary formation theories and understanding the atmospheres of both planet and rocky exoplanets. So there it is. The James Webb Telescope has yet come through with a new discovery there. So I think that's rather interesting. Alrighty then, space weather. Let's see what's happening up in space. Currently, the solar wind is at 446.1 kilometers a second at a density of 8.1 protons per cubic centimeter. The current disk of the sun, which I can bring up here, has, I think that's four sunspots on the disk of the sun, designated AR 3092, 3091, and a little bit hard to read the others, 3083 I think it is, and 3086, they're kind of mingled in there. But you can see this magnificent image there of the sun with those current sunspots on the disk of the sun facing Earth at the moment. The sunspot number is 67, and the radio sun, the solar flux, is currently at 116 solar flux units. That's measured at a wavelength of 10.7 centimeters. So the radio sun is currently 116 solar flux units, which would be matching the sunspot number. Geomagnetic Storm Watch, G2. NOAA forecasters say that G1 minor to G2 class moderate geomagnetic storms are possible on September 4, when a stream of solar wind is expected to hit Earth's magnetic field. The gaseous material is growing from a large hole in the sun's atmosphere. If the storm materializes, auroras could be visible in the USA as far south as Idaho and New York, if you're in the north. Okay, skipping a whole lot of other stuff there. Potentially hazardous asteroids are space rocks larger than approximately 100 meters that can come closer to Earth more than 0.05 AU. None of the known potentially hazardous asteroids is on a collision course with our planet, although astronomers are finding new ones all the time. On the 2nd of September 2022, there were 2,281 potentially hazardous asteroids. I do love the way they do emphasize that, potentially hazardous asteroids. So at any moment, we could just be puffed out. Puffed out? That's probably a better word. All right, having said that, I think that's about the end of tonight's session. I didn't think I'd go for an hour, but there it is. It's always the way. All right, thanks everybody for watching and listening to my going-ons. So like I said at the beginning of the broadcast, we're basically back on deck for the beginning of a new month. Tune in to NASA TV tomorrow. Hopefully, we're crossing fingers. See, I'm trying to cross fingers here too. Very difficult to do. For a successful launch of Artemis. And it's about, I think it's about 18 hours away is the timing. The countdown timer, I think 18 hours maybe. So yeah, pay attention and hopefully it'll launch successfully. All right, so this is VK3 Echo Kilo Hotel, the official station of the Astronomical Society of Victoria, with the regular Friday night broadcast coming to you from the studios of VK3 Charlie Sierra Juliet in Narre Warren South. And I just want to thank the guys that have sent me emails there. There's a few more, actually. I can see an email that's come in from VK5WA. And one from Brett Dawson up there at New South Wales. G'day, Brett, VK2CBD. And Ian Westland, VK3VIN. He's welcomed me back there as well. And he says he's good to hear you on the radio again. Thanks, Ian. Yeah, cool stuff. And that's Dallas, VK5WA. Thanks, Dallas. Thanks, guys, for the emails. I do appreciate that. The chaps up there on the chat window, VK5FUSC, and Martin, VK7JAH, and Andrew, VK3BQ, and Richard, VK3VRS, who chats to me in the over my shoulder here if things aren't going to air properly. Okay, enough of that. So this is VK3EKH, concluding the transmission on 1865 AM, our medium wave service. There won't be any callback on 160 metres, but we'll do a callback of sorts on 80 metres on 3541. So standby stations on 80 metres. This is VK3EKH with VK3CSJ. Again, any further information about the society, just go to the website www.asv.org.au. Oh dear, and all will be revealed, as they say. Good evening to everybody listening on 1865 AM. This is VK3EKH concluding signal, standby stations on 80 metres. All right, gives the linear time to cool down. All right, so I got my pen. All right, yep. Standby. Let's see how this works. VK3EKH, listening on 3541 for any stations wishing to check in. All right, now it might be one, two stations there I've lost. VK3BDA. VK3BDA, I think it was. VK3HDX, VK3VIN, VK3BSE, VK5WA, and VK3INDIA KILO. Is there any other stations? All right, there's a very weak station just there. Now, the two stations that came up, you doubled a little bit, so I still didn't get the call signs. I got VK5KKT, but VK3, there's two VK3 stations that doubled. Let's see if I can grab you again. Go ahead. And the other VK3? All right, there was I'm pretty sure there's another VK3 there. So VK3B, VK3BDA, VK3HDX, VK3VIN, 3BSE, VK5WA, VK3IK, VK3GL, not very strong, Graham, and VK5KKT. Was there anybody else? Okay, VK7 Juliet Alpha Hotel. Cool. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That's not too bad. I'm happy with that. Oh, my nose is playing up all of a sudden. All right. Over to you there, Graham. VK3BDA, the Bendigo District Astronomical Society. Official call sign. VK3BDA, VK3EKH.
Difficult time, and a lot to work through, and well, you have my my condolences. Good to be on the nest again. I'm playing with my new toy, the 7300, which turned up yesterday, so I thought I'd better come on and join the net, and I've been playing around with VK3 PDG this evening as well. So I didn't get to catch all the net, but I thought I'd join in the net. So we have our regular Thursday meetings, the third Thursday of the month, the Bendigo section of the ASV by Zoom, and they're always a lot of fun with the members showing images of what they've been doing with the telescopes, and it's amazing what people have been coming up with astrophotography wise. And the other bit of information that I presented on the last meeting was the benefits of actually joining a library in regards to having access to magazines or electronic access to a lot of these really good magazines, like really good quality astronomical magazines and photography magazines and so forth. If you join a, I guess most libraries would have access to these things electronically. So I'm a member of the Goldfields Library now, and which someone reminded me of a while ago about the access that you can get to a lot of these really good magazines. So just something that people might be interested in if you're wanting to look at different astronomy magazines and photography and all that sort of thing that is in line with astronomy, then that's another avenue of information and access to a lot of the magazines that would otherwise cost quite a bit of money, but you can actually access them for free just via joining the library. I just put it back to you there, Clint, and good to hear you on the net once again, and good evening to everybody. Have a great weekend. VK3EKH, VK3BDO in Bendigo. Back to you there, Clint.
Yeah, thanks, Graham. VK3BDA, Bendigo, VK3EKH, returning you 20 over 9 down here, so the radio's working very well for you. Sounds good through the hi-fi speaker here. It's not sounding too bad at all. So, working for you very well indeed. And sorry to hear about your mum too. It's, anyway, we won't harp on it, but... yes, I suspect it's going to take me a little while to get used to her not being around. So, yes. All right. Thanks, Graham. And I think you're referring to the Society's library, I think. I'm not too sure which library it was now. You might have mentioned it, but I was writing down on the paper here. But if you are referring to the ASV library, I concur. That the ASV Library is very extensive in its collection of books, magazines, and articles, and videos, and DVDs, and you can't go wrong with the library. Beautiful to walk into the ASV Library, you get bowled over by the smell of aging books. It's it's like opening up that was the other thing I was going to mention. There's two new books that I've got here. I'll have to wait till next week on that one. All right, thanks, Graham. Good on you. Don, VK3HDX, VK3EKH, have a say.
Yeah, thanks, Clint. Good evening, VK3EKH and the group, VK3HDX. Thanks for the broadcast tonight. Interesting as always. Looking forward to the Artemis launch. I'll be keeping an eye on the NASA TV for that. I won't hold it. You've got a lot of people to get through tonight. So thanks for the broadcast, and we'll look forward to next week.
VK3EKH and the group VK3HDX. Get on you, Don. VK3HDX, VK3EKH, not a problem. So you're 25 over 9, so not a bad signal coming into good old Narre Warren South. Thanks, Don. Ian, VK3VIN, VK3EKH, how are you?
Good too. was all about. But from what you were reading tonight, it sounds like it's in vitreous form. And, living in highly radioactive situations, and water, and discovering the world all over again, which is really what it is, isn't it? It's a brand new frontier.
VK3VIN, Kangaroo Flat, VK3EKH. No worries, Ian. Not the strongest of signals I've heard from you tonight, but you're hovering around 15 over. 5 and 9 plus 15, but I have heard you stronger. Nevertheless, yes, you are correct. One of the panels of the mirror was hit by a micrometeorite. And it was actually sufficiently damaged that it has impaired the function of the telescope by a small percentage. Scientists believed that they would be able to correct for the damaged mirror. It's only just one of the segments has been hit by a micrometeorite, and they initially thought that they'd be able to correct it through alignment or software or somehow, but from what I remember reading, the damage is too great to be repairable in another way of doing it. So, but it doesn't affect the overall performance of the telescope. They can still use the telescope to its full capability, and if that damaged mirror segment is going to affect the image, then I'm sure that they can correct the information that they're getting. I haven't heard anything more about that, but I do believe that the impact caused by a micrometeorite has caused just enough damage to cause, you know, they haven't been able to compensate for it. So, but again, the telescope is still perfectly usable, fortunately. But it just goes to show that in all the vastness of space, you've got this a space probe, and it gets hit by a micrometeorite. It just goes to show how much stuff is shooting around in space, and if we have any idea about traveling to other worlds, let alone to Mars, the risk of micrometeorites is there. We haven't got shields like Star Trek. That's still way off into the future. So these spacecraft that are going to be traveling off to Mars in the near future, the construction of it has to be strong enough to withhold bullet type projectiles, probably lined with the bulletproof material that's worn by the police. You know, what do they call that? There's a name for it. But I can just imagine that the spaceship will have to be aligned so that these micrometeorites just don't penetrate. It can happen. It's a very dangerous thing to be doing, space travel. Thanks, Ian. All right. Now, I think this is a new station that's joining us tonight, I think. I think it's John, VK3 Bravo Sierra Echo. I might be wrong. VK3 BSE, VK3 CSJ, EKH. Go ahead, John. Thanks, John. VK3BSE, VK3EKH. All right, John. Not a very strong signal here. My noise floor is what is it? Hang on. Yeah, my noise floor is hovering around 10/9. It's actually quite high. I don't know why it should be so high, but my noise floor is around 10/9. There's no preamps on, so. Yeah, just a little bit competing with that noise floor, John. But you're hovering around 15/9, about that, with a little bit of QSB. I was just checking. There's a on that first article that I read out about Artemis. There's a link to the YouTube channel NASA Live Artemis 1 launch, and it actually says live in 26 hours. 4th of September at 02:15. I don't know whether that's local or UTC, doesn't say, but it says live in 26 hours, so we've still got 26 hours to go before things go live on NASA TV, according to this. I don't know. Anyway, it'll give us we've got plenty of time to suss out when to tune into NASA TV and to check it out. Hopefully, like I say, the launch will be successful this time. All right, thanks John for checking in, and thanks for listening too. Excellent stuff. Dallas, VK5 Whiskey Alpha, VK3 EKH, go ahead. No worries, Dallas, VK5, Whiskey Alpha, VK3, EKH returning. Good signal, 100% copy here, and you're about peaking 20, peaking to up to 20 over 9. So no problems in hearing you, Dallas. And it's like the space shuttle. It's a very complex system. And as we all know, they've got to make sure that they get a green light for everything. I mean, there's not one part of the rocket, the same with the space shuttle, that's not being checked, monitored, measured. And when it comes up to that last 5 seconds before switching on, you know, lighting those rockets, everything has still got to be green. Everything has to be ready to go. So I don't know how they could make that any simpler. It's just when, I guess, when human life's involved in, on top of these rockets, you've just got to make sure that everything is a goer, or else. So, the moment of launch is a white knuckle sort of scenario. You know, everybody in the control room is just holding their breath. So, anyway, very scary stuff, isn't it? Thanks, Dallas. Right, Chris, VK3 India Kilo, I think it was, VK3 IK, VK3 EKH. Well, I think I'm pretty sure I got the right call sign. Anything that sounds like IK, VK3 India Kilo. Or did I miss the B? I know it's BIK. Maybe it was BI. I'm not sure. VK3 IK, was it? VK3 EKH.
I think he
was 2. Oh, yeah? Okay. VK2 IK. My apologies. VK2, is it? VK2 IK, VK3 EKH? All right, that's okay. That's what I thought it was too. Okay, when you gotta go, you gotta go. thanks, Chris. If you're in an earshot, maybe on your phone, I don't know. But thanks, Chris. Well, maybe you can call in a short moment. I'll go back to you when I come to the bottom of the list. Mr. Lewis, VK3GL, VK3EKH.
Scrub is typical.
And I'd trust everything's going okay. If you're still about at the end of the callback session, might have a bit of a chat if time permits. Thanks again, mate, and good to catch you. VK3DKH, VK3GL.
Yeah, thanks, Graeme. you're running any linear tonight, or it's just straight 100 watts? Okay. You're not very strong. You're hovering around 15 to 20, so, I mean, that's good enough, but usually you're definitely stronger, so the short skip isn't happening tonight. Anyway, thanks, Graeme. Not a problem. And no, scrub is a very common terminology NASA uses. They've been using scrub mission, or at least the media has, for years. That's a common term that they use. Pulling the plug wouldn't be the right word, really. Never heard them say pull the plug. Maybe here in Australia, yeah, we'll pull the plug on that one, yeah. All right, thanks, Graeme. Ian, VK5, Kilo, Kilo, Tango to take it. VK3, EKH. G'day, Ian. Thanks, Ian. VK5, double K, T2 Worlds. VK3, EKH replying. Not a problem, Ian. You're 22 over 9. Quite a consistent 22 over 9, I have to add, when I'm looking at the S meter here. So that's why I made it an accurate reading, going by eye. But yeah, good signal. And yeah, thanks, Ian. Good to hear you. And it's not nice when you've got a headache. As soon as I've got the slightest twinge of a headache, I'm right on to the Panadol. I hate headaches, I really do. Good, thanks, Ian. And finally, we have VK7JAH down there in Launceston. Have a say, Martin. VK7JAH, VK3EKH. VK7JAH, VK3EKH. Yes, okay, Martin. you're about 10 over, hovering around 10 over, which is just a little bit above my noise floor at the moment. So I was basically hearing you okay, but it was just a little bit hard to copy everything you were saying exactly. But I did hear you say that I was 30 over 9, and probably the strongest of the signals you've heard from me in a long time, I think was the comment that you made. So, I'm using an old Yaesu linear tonight, one that I purchased some time ago, and it's the first time powered up tonight. It may not have worked, but it did, fortunately. An old 2100B, is it what it is? 21, 2100B. Good old Yaesu linear. If anybody's watching the TV, they can just see it over my on my right shoulder there on the, in the rack. I'm kind of working on the other linear that I normally use. It's the changeover relay was playing me up, so I'm working on that. So I'm using this one at the moment, and I'm glad to say that it is working reasonably well. Just close to 400 odd watts. So it seems to be handling that. A good old smell of dust came out of the top of the lid as the valves warmed up. Oh, pardon me. Anyway, thanks, Martin. And I love the way you get up there on the chat window as well. So it's excellent stuff. All right, now, was there any other stations wishing to check in tonight before we finish? VK3EKH. Or who was that again? Oh, is it you, Kim? VK5FUSE, VK3EKH. Was it 5 and 9 plus 10, did you say? Yeah, it's tricky to hear there, Kim. I can tell you there, but it's just a little bit tricky to hear. But I think you're giving me a report of 5, 9 plus 10 or so. You can just say that up on the chat window if you like. dear. All right, thanks, Kim. You're in the log. No worries. All right, any other stations? VK3, EKH. Noise is all I hear. All right. Thank you very much, Lee, everybody, for checking in tonight. I do appreciate the stations there that do pop in at the end, even though it's nearly midnight. So thanks very much, Lee. And let's hope that September proves to be a little bit more looking forward sort of a month. And again, let's hope that Artemis 1 launches without any issues. So be looking forward to that. On that note, this is VK3 Echo Kilo Hotel, the official station for the Astronomical Society of Victoria, concluding transmission for tonight on 3541 and on YouTube. Thank you very much for watching as well, and we'll be back next Wednesday to do it all again. So this is VK3EKH, I've already said that. Any further information you want on the society, just go to the website, www.asv.org.au. Cheers for now, everyone. Take care. VK3EKH clear. All right, let's conclude the YouTube stream. So thank you for watching on YouTube. Just send us an email to vk3ekh@gmail.com. If you've been watching on the YouTube stream, be interested to know if anybody has been watching YouTube, particularly on the other side of the world. So having said that, we shall... just hang on a sec, Gray. I'm finishing elsewhere. So we'll see you all next week. Anyway, have a safe week and take care. So we shall just go to color bars. And for those watching RTV, I might as well finish up there as well. We have the WIA broadcast on Sunday morning at 10:30, followed by the Old Timer Club Net News Bulletin, News Bulletin. So WI News at 10:30, 11 o'clock, the Old Timers Net Bulletin, News Bulletin, which goes for half an hour. And then we shall repeat that at 8 o'clock at night. So everybody have a nice weekend and take care for and look after yourselves. Right. Fade to color bars.